Sovereign citizens, they look just like you and me, only they're exempt from the laws of the land, aren't required to pay taxes, and don't have to obey the will of courts, either law or food. At least, that's what they believe.
I'm private, so I'm not under any public law.
Natural license? You're just operating under your own...
Law of Morality, L-O-R-E.
Sovereign citizen origin can be traced to an American group in the 1970s who promoted anti-government conspiracy theories. But the movement has exploded recently in the wake of pandemic response measures.
Look, the tinfoil hat-wearing brigade are alive and well out there in our community, and they're taking every opportunity to leverage the current situation to serve their own ridiculous notions about so-called sovereign citizens.
The core of their belief is that anyone must first consent to laws in order to be governed by them, a sort of opt-in box for democratic rule. They often cite Magna Carta in their defence. Not Jay-Z and Beyoncé's little-known fourth child, but the Charter of Rights agreed to by King John in the 13th century. Former magistrate David Hulpern has heard hundreds of arguments from people who believe they don't have to obey laws they don't like and says none of them hold water.
You don't need a driving license to travel with your automobile.
Yes, we do.
You need a driving license if you make money for what you're doing, if it's for commerce.
So is this movement just a handful of people with a misguided concept of freedom or something we should be concerned about?
And former magistrate David Halpern joins us now. David, you've had hundreds of sovereign citizens before you in court. What do you think is at the heart of all this?
Look, I think the movement has grown considerably over the last couple of years, post-COVID, post the anti-vaccination movement. I think that gave it a boost. And I think that people are looking to challenge the law, which is a healthy thing, but this is really the extreme end of it. And people seem to be after a quick fix to avoid penalties and fines and their own liability for things that would otherwise be crimes.
What I don't understand is, isn't the point of the sovereign citizen that their claims wouldn't hold up in court? So they're trying to claim separation from the legal system.
There's two players at work here. There's the people who come to court and try and argue it, and then there's the people behind the movement who are selling kits online and selling the story online that you can beat your charges by claiming a pseudo-law argument that you're a sovereign citizen, that you're a member of a corporate state, that if you change your name to a person, that magistrates have no power. And those people are the ones who are really promoting the argument and quoting all these cases that they say they've won. So that's right. The whole idea is the law doesn't apply. And then they come to court and argue that the law doesn't apply.
And around we go. You say nobody has successfully argued the sovereign citizen case. Have they just not found the right argument?
No. I think, look, unique arguments are terrific. Mabo was an argument that overturned years of terra nullius. But this is so left field. I mean, this is people claiming that the criminal laws just don't apply to them because they decide that they are no longer part of the corporate entity known as Australia under the Magna Carta and all the other stuff that they go on with. So it really is so way out there that it doesn't have any possibility of ever being upheld by any court, and it never has been.
Well, you say that, David, until one of them's your client, right? I mean, you're a lawyer and you like playing with legal arguments. If one of them came to you and you were going to represent them, could you construct an argument? Could you think of anything you'd be able to say to the court?
Look, lawyers have a responsibility. Their first responsibility is to their clients, but also they have a responsibility to the court. And if I was asked to put some of those pseudo-law arguments, I would say, no, I've got a responsibility to only put arguments that carry some legal weight. And if they're absolute gobbledygook and complete garbage and from fantasy land, then I wouldn't put them. I'd go and tell them to get another lawyer or represent themselves. And that is why, incidentally, they largely represent themselves, because they're not going to find a lawyer who will besmirch their own reputation and break their own professional rules by arguing something that they know is complete garbage.
David, it's always fascinating to speak to you. Thank you so much for your time tonight.
Thank you.